hey, you know, this is what we do. This is how we roll, man.
SportsCenter with Jay and Dan. Coming in to focus on your television screens, we are thrilled you tuned in. Our show is brought to you by our friends at Tim Hortons. Listen, Dan, I've written two best-selling books about the fact that I've struggled with stomach issues throughout my life. Nobody empathizes with Joel Embiid more than I do because he was a game-time decision for the Raptors, game number two against Philadelphia.
Number two.
That was my second book.
Flu-like symptoms. That's just the flu.
Yeah, right. It's like concussion-like symptoms.
That's a concussion.
Exactly.
Okay, so it was game-time decision. Did he play in game two? Raptors leading the series one game to none, and they're riding a franchise-best five-game playoff winning streak. Embiid did play. Does not look good. First quarter. Norm Powell. Denied by Embiid. Raps shot 29% in the quarter. They trailed by nine. Second quarter, Embiid kicks out to Jimmy Butler. I think he only attempted one shot in the first half. Jimmy Butler three and the foul. Looks like Butler kicked out his legs. Danny Green gets a technical for arguing. Raps down 13 the half. Sixers missed their first four shots of the third, leading to a 10-2 Raptors run to start the half. Marc Gasol, pair of assists, and Gasol for three. Raps 4-10 from deep in the quarter, down six after three. So they've trimmed it. Fourth quarter, Green. He had a lot of wide open looks and a lot of misses. Raps shot 10 of 37 from deep. Butler coast to coast. Runner, give him the foul too. Butler only had 10 points in game one, put up 30 in game two. Under four to play. Kawhi into traffic, muscles it up, and one. Leonard scores 35. Had seven rebounds, six assists, under 2 minutes left. Raps down six. Leonard to Lowry for three. Lowry had 20. Under 30 seconds to go. Sixers up one. Embiid drives, fakes, and lays it in. He had 12 points. So the Raps need a three to tie. Lowry loses the handle, gets it back, finds Kawhi to Green, wide open. No guy. Used with permission. Sixers secure the rebound. Green, one of eight from the field. Philly gets the split in Toronto. That is huge. As the Sixers beat the Raptors in Toronto for the first time in their last 15 attempts. And also, Kawhi loses to the Sixers for the first time in his career. Raptors struggled offensively in game two compared to a much better game one. Shot over 50% in the first game. They went 36% from the field in game two. Very different story. And to a man who helped call the game, Jack Armstrong, who's at Scotiabank Arena. So the Raptors put up 108 points in game one. They win that game. And then in game two, they only muster 89 points. What changed?
Well, I thought, give Philadelphia a lot of credit. I thought they did a great job tonight with their scheme. As tremendous as Kawhi Leonard was again for the Raptors, he was having to do it against two, three defenders at times. And the Raptors' secondary scoring just was inconsistent tonight. And beyond Kawhi Leonard, they weren't able to get enough of that high-level ability to play off of him. That was the difference.
Jack, we saw after the game, Marc Gasol went over and spoke to the officials. I think I saw Kyle Lowry speaking to the officials, and I heard you and Matt talking about that. How much of an impact do you think the officiating had on the outcome of game two?
Well, there were some inconsistencies tonight, and obviously if you're a Raptor fan, you're gonna be displeased with some of them. Obviously, as we know, this was not an easy game to officiate on either side. It was sloppy, it was hard-nosed, physical defense, and, you know, there were some calls that definitely I disagreed with, and as well as Nick Nurse and Danny Green and Kyle Lowry and a lot of Raptors. But ultimately, when you look at this game, as much as there's frustration with the officiating, the Raptors had a ton of opportunities with open opportunities in terms of shots. If a few of those go down, that's kind of a secondary story. But the inability to kind of have secondary scoring beyond Kawhi Leonard really hurt them. And I'll go to this. You look at Philadelphia tonight, and they came in here and they played the ideal road game. They played a really solid team defense. I think Jimmy Butler was excellent in this game. Embiid came up big late with a clutch rebound, a tremendous assist to Jimmy Butler, a big-time three-point play. And when it was all said and done, we have a series on our hands now. And these teams are figuring each other out. And now it's time for Toronto, without home court advantage anymore, next two in Philadelphia, to figure things out at a higher level.
Hey, as you said, Jack, we have a series. Thank you so much, my friend.
Guys, my pleasure.
And I explained our theory on yesterday's show. No one outside of Dallas has watched the Stars play hockey since they won the Cup in 99. How else to explain Miro Heiskanen being left off the Calder Trophy ballot? But don't feel sorry for the Stars rookie defenseman. He said, I don't care. They are good players also. So I'm having fun here in playoffs. That's what he said. And why wouldn't he have fun? The Stars are in the second round. And they're taking on the Blues. And this game three, the series tied at one, this game three had everything. Jaden Schwartz playing with Vladimir Tarasenko and Ryan O'Reilly and scoring just 87 seconds into the game. Schwartz with the sixth. St. Louis up 1-0. Still in the period. Robert Bortuzzo, chance to clear it, can't get it out. Jason Spezza, oh yeah, he's playing great. To Alexander Radulov for his fifth of the playoffs. And you know who's enjoying this? Ezekiel Elliott, wearing a really cool sweatshirt. It's tied at one after one. We're going to the second. The Robert Thomas shot will squeeze through Ben Bishop, and Tyler Bozak is there to put it home to snap a seven-game goal drought for Bozy. Restore St. Louis lead. Then Bortuzzo shoving down Esa Lindell. Bortuzzo calling for the dive. Lindell goes down easy again. Very Neymar-esque. And a third time. Both players receiving minors. That was pretty comical. From there, things go wild. Blues power playing the third. 2-1 St. Louis. Braden Schenn's pass misses everybody. And here's an odd man rush for Dallas. Matthias Janmark sends it in front. Alex Cogliano scores the second to tie it at two apiece. Just after Dallas kills a penalty, they're stuck with three defensemen on, and it's the Blues captain who's going to make them play. Alex Pietrangelo first of the playoffs. Restores that St. Louis lead. Dallas, though, still with four to go. Heiskanen, how about that beautiful pass to Tyler Seguin? Come on! This guy would win the Calder if Pettersson wasn't in the league. That is our friend Kenny Albert on the call. This goal was so bizarre. Patty Maroon just steps in front and scores. St. Louis is in front for the fourth time. Less than a minute to go. Colton Parayko, big Blues defenseman, trying to clear it. Called for delay of game, so Dallas has one last chance. Dying seconds. Scrambling to get it into the zone. Heiskanen sends it on net. It misses wide. Stars unable to erase St. Louis's fourth lead, and the Blues improved to 4-0 on the road in the postseason. By the way, apparently I called Andrew Cogliano Alex Cogliano. I apologize to all the Coglianos. I had Alex Pietrangelo on the mic. That's my excuse. Stars have taken 15 minor penalties over these three games already. Jordan Binnington tying the league record for the fewest starts to reach 30 victories.
Trailblazers Nuggets. Their second round series could be this series of the playoffs, and it just started. Why not? The teams finished the regular season separated by one game. Denver 1-7 against the Spurs, while the Blazers, what happened in their first round series? How'd that end again? I forget.
Lillard, long range three, and it's good! At the buzzer! Damian Lillard, are you kidding me?
Oh, right. So, yeah, that will be tough to top. Game one. Denver won 3 of 4 against Portland in the regular season. First quarter, Damian Lillard turns it over. Jamal Murray, he is Canadian, picks up a loose ball. I'll shoot it from here. Same spot. Yep. Murray coming off a clutch shot in game 7 against San Antonio. Off balance jumper in the paint. Murray, 10 points in the first. Lillard, he hit that memorable first round against OKC. He likes deep threes. This one, not so deep. Lillard averaging 33 points in the playoffs. Third quarter off a Will Barton miss. Lillard. Deep range, way out. Yeah, that's where he likes him. Lillard finishes on the opposite side. Lillard had 15 points in the first half. It's an interesting play. Murray steals, looking for Malik Beasley. Beasley, whoops! He wiped out. Denver led by 3 at the half. Early third, Murray to Gary Harris. Orders 3. Murray gets by Lillard, gives Denver a 7-point lead. They're in the third quarter. Denver continues to lead. Kent, let's take this in here before I get... I don't want to inundate you while you're deciphering information on your own. Now this is where I join you. Denver's playing in the second round for the first time in a decade. Should they win the series, the Blazers will make their first West Final since 2000. Do we need any more? We're good. Still to come, the Leafs' loss is Canada's game as rosters are announced ahead of the World Hockey Championships. Find out who will wear the red and white next.
Look. Okay, here we go. Let's get over here to talk about things.
Oh, look, we got a Game of Thrones inspired walkover clock.
Now, have you heard of this show, Dan? It's got wizards and goblins.
I know what the short form for it is. GOT.
We've got GOT on Crave TV.
Yes.
Right?
It's huge.
You're welcome, Bell Media. Team Canada announced its 22-man roster for the upcoming World Hockey Championship. Big names. Johnny Toronto, Mark Stone, there's Darnell Nurse, there's Matt Murray. They'll all be there. Canada will have 7 players who previously represented the Canadians at Worlds, 3 returnees from last year, and 3 players who won gold with Canada at this tournament. You can see the full roster on our website. It's www.tsn.org.
I'm sorry.
CA.
.ca.
Extra special for 4 players in particular who have never represented Canada in IIHF competition. You're looking at Jonathan Marchessault. Troy Stetchett.
Canucks.
Brandon Montour.
Buffalo.
And Tyler Bertuzzi.
Of your Red Wings.
You know who else is going to be there?
Who's that?
Darren Dreger.
Oh, Dreger's Cafe. That's one of our most popular shows on TSN.
That's right. And Dreger says all signs point to Jack Hughes joining his brother Quinn on a stacked Team USA squad at the World Hockey Championship. Hughes is fresh off the under-18s, where he set a tournament record with 32 points, beating Alex Ovechkin's old record for a 2-tournament total.
Dan, the Americans have a stacked roster at the World Hockey Championships. Let me just throw some names out at you.
Okay.
Alex DeBrincat.
Okay.
Patrick Kane.
Oh.
Clayton Keller.
Boom.
How about this? Jack Eichel. Ryan Suter. Corey Schneider. He's not as good as he used to be. But the bottom line is the Americans look very good. Now, Hurricanes goalie Peter Mrazek, not so good. He's considered day-to-day, according to Luke DeCock of the Raleigh News and Observer. That's Luke DeCock. The netminder left Sunday's Game 2 win over the Islanders in the second period with what's being described as a lower body injury, placed by Curtis McElhaney, who stopped all 17 shots he faced. Understand the Canes called up a goaltender, though.
Alex Nedeljkovic from the Checkers. He has 1 career NHL start.
And was that information courtesy of Luke DeCock?
Didn't get it from the cock here.
Okay.
A dramatic double overtime winner from Matt Duchene evened up the series between the Jackets and Bruins. And for the first time in franchise history, the Jackets will host a second-round playoff game Tuesday night. It is going to be loud there. Before Game 3, Brandon Dubinsky has something else to celebrate, his birthday.
An old party tonight, obviously, get ready for the next game. Hopefully they can, I mean, there's a lot of cash in this locker room, so hopefully they can all pull some money together and buy me something real nice, you know?
What are you, 26 now?
27, thanks for asking.
27.
He's 33.
He's got one goal in the postseason. Artemi Panarin, though, the Breadman, points in all six of the Blue Jackets playoff games. 9 points in all, 4 goals, 5 assists.
Hey,
the Breadman, he's going to be making that bread. He's unrestricted at the end of the season.
Can we make sure we focus on the cannons being fired during that game if the Jackets score? Because we want to see what the people do around the cannons because they do lots of hijinks. So just note that so I don't have to remind you on Wednesday, Producer Tim, in the next game.
When we come back, Dan, it is another action-packed edition of The Best and Worst from Monday. Plus, we'll see how Producer Tim's doing with that request you made. We need an updated Tim Hortons drive-thru graphic where we have our beards. And then we have Timbit crumbs in our beards. Raptors lost to the Sixers 94-89, ties their second-round NBA playoff series at one game apiece. Jimmy Butler, 30 points. He was very good. Blues take a 2-1 series lead over Dallas thanks to a 4-3 win. Patty Maroon right there. You see it. He scores the winning goal with a minute 30 left in regulation. Blues 4 straight playoff win, tied for the most in franchise history.
The Gannies. Yuli Gurriel pops one down the first baseline. Marwin Gonzalez. Yes, guy. Use with permission. Nice catch.
Braves pitcher Mike Soroka is from Calgary. Here he is at the plate.
He does get the bunt down.
Laying the bunt down. Eric Hosmer tries to get the lead runner, but throws it into center. Soroka ends up on third. A run comes in to score. And Dan, I believe you mentioned Soroka 8 strikeouts. Career high.
Career high. Jamal Murray in transition, and Malik Beasley slips and falls.
I love Murray's reaction here. He's like, oh.
He was running too fast and tried to switch that into running backwards and too fast.
Spicy Pete. This was a beautiful baseline move on Joel Embiid. Gorgeous. Love it.
I love Patty Maroon when he scores his goal. He doesn't know if it's in and if he should celebrate. He's like, I think it's... And now I can celebrate. Let's see here. He figures it's in. Doesn't want to look like a Maroon and celebrate too early.
I love Kenny Albert on those calls. Ennis Kanter fouled by Paul Millsap. Millsap thought it should be a jump ball. His coach, Mike Malone, thought it should be a jump ball. Or do they think it's a good call? Do you think it's a good call? No, you think it's a jump ball.
Yes, it is.
Lorenzo King got robbed by Ryan McMahon earlier. Also denied by Daniel Murphy.
Yeah, the vet.
At first.
Yeah, the first one, you know, you tip your hat. The second one, you say, you really...
Nikola Jokic.
Jamal Murray.
Takes feet from Jamal Murray. He finds Gary Harris. It's not about sex, Gary. It's about trust. And reverse layups. Before we get to the plays of the week, it's time for our newest segment here on the show. Jack Armstrong, world's most enthusiastic pitchman.
Closed captioning is brought to you by GoDaddy Canada.
Who's your daddy, money deep?
Hello, I'm Jack Armstrong, and I'll sell your stuff.
This has been Jack Armstrong, enthusiastic pitchman. Now, you may have noticed during Game 2 between the Sixers and Raptors, there was a fan sitting courtside, a Philadelphia fan, and he was the most annoying human in the city of Toronto by far. Look at this guy. Can you imagine sitting in the rows behind this idiot?
And those seats would be probably about $5,000 for this game.
This is just awful. What do you do in that situation? You throw food at him?
No, you want to follow the rules. You don't want to get kicked out, but you ask the usher, can we
and throw some food at him. Not good food either.
You know who else was there courtside at game two? Let's have a celebrity roll call.
Hey, let's have our celebrity
roll call. The hottest ticket in town. There's Drake. He's always there. Milos Raonic was there. Mitch Marner in attendance. Halsey was there. Taylor Hall.
And he's got a tan.
PK Subban and girlfriend Lindsey Vonn in attendance, courtside, drinking Red Bull.
They were having a good time, except for the people sitting behind that fan.
Houston Rockets believe that the officiating in Game 7 of 2018's Western Conference Finals cost them a shot at the NBA Championship. In a report sent to the league, there were 81 potential missed calls and non-calls in that game against the Warriors. And in Game 1 against Golden State in this year's Western Semis, the NBA ruled that Steph Curry should have fouled out. Steve Kerr wasn't fazed by the Rockets' claim.
Hang on.
Jeez. Who's that foul on? Is that on Ann?
That was on Ann.
You saw in the background there, that's a mock-up of the Chase Center. That's the new Golden State Arena they'll be moving into next year. It's in San Francisco. Yeah. Looks pretty nice. Wonder if there'll be any ATMs in it.
Chase is a bank.
There's been plenty of speculation surrounding Kevin Durant's landing spot after this season. Warrior fans hoping the soon-to-be free agent visits Flavor Town before making his choice. Longtime Warrior fan and celebrity chef Guy Fieri is offering to cook KD an inspirational meal in an effort to keep him in the Bay Area, saying, "Tell me how I need to flex my food muscles, and I'll make it happen."
He's a character.
You know, he is also a friend of SportsCenter with Jay and Dan. Mm-hmm. Here's a shot of myself, Dan, and Guy hanging out at Dan's wedding.
We looked so young and inspired.
And we continue to be inspired. I'm upset. It looks like I'm upset because the paparazzi are taking our picture. I'm like, hey, we're just trying to celebrate Dan's nuptials. Okay, just give us a break from the cameras for once. All day we have to deal with that stuff from all the paps in Toronto.
And then he sent us, this is true, sent us to his restaurant, and on the menu they had tater tots.
Yeah, and we all got them.
A pair of high-profile athletes are tying the knot. TFC forward, Jose Altidore, and tennis star Sloane Stephens announced their engagement on social media Monday. The couple has been together since 2016.
Jose Altidore was on our show, and we gave him a little marriage advice. We said, invite Guy Fieri to your wedding.
And us. We're all great wedding guests.
We're available, Josie.
Still to come. After this NFL prospect was drafted, he left his brother high and dry. So we're counting down the best left-hanging moments in the SportsCenter Top 10. Wait, Clayton Thorson is married? He's only 23. We'll save that for another day. But after being drafted by the Eagles, the quarterback denied his brother a hand clasp and then a hug. It was a double denial. It's the top 10 left-hanging moments, but this top 10 somehow does not include the best one ever. And that's Yao Ming on his...
How could this have been left out?
It's draft day. Okay, so here we go. What do we got? Top 10 left-hanging moments. Alex Gordon hits a home run.
This is our Chrysler.
He's round of the bases.
First inning with two on.
And he fakes out his third base coach.
Alex Ovechkin feeds Brett Connolly. Brett Connolly goes to the backhand and scores, then back on the bench. Their teammate Evgeny Kuznetsov is looking for some love. Is himself the fist tap.
Nikola Jokic waiting patiently to give Wilson Chandler a high five. Then he's like, I guess I'll just do it myself.
He kind of wiped his hands of the whole thing.
Literally.
Nets wraps 2014 postseason after a Kyle Lowry basket.
Look at this, fans going in for the smooch. She's like, eh. No. He looks so sad when it doesn't work out, too.
President George W. Bush hosted the first T-ball All-Star game. Did not go well. We'll see about Emily in a bit.
Interception. Check him out. Tavon Wilson, he's going to the distance. Touchdown. Now let's just flashback, all right? Because the Patriots, they always got success. Stephen Ridley, earlier in the season, into the end zone. Stretches it out. When he's not fumbling, he's scoring touchdowns. Tom Brady on the sideline, can't get no dap from nobody. Tom Brady yesterday during the game, he's the only player on the team. Somebody dap him up. He's the only ball player you got. Come on, Patriots.
Rays and White Sox, Richie Shaker. It's a home run. It's his first career Major League hit.
For Richie Schaefer.
No, he comes like this always happens, right? They always give you the silent treatment. In this case, the Rays are. Schaefer, classic. He's miming.
Over to the one guy who's not really there, but they're back and forth.
Gronk scores a touchdown. Robert Kraft. We all know what you're thinking now when we see him.
The best part is the script says, Robert Kraft looking for some love. Oh, isn't he always? 2005 Little League softball semifinal. Ken Slowick wants to celebrate with his team, and they just run right past him. I guess this is obviously from Pardon the Interruption. 2005. Wow.
And Jordan Eberle, 2011 World Hockey Championship. He goes to. She's like, no, I don't.
Classic Eberle.
You know why? She didn't want the hockey glove smell.
Yeah. Maybe she wasn't. What do you think she said to him?
I'm not allowed to. Touch our hand.
Did he shake the donkey's hand?
And later, Jordan married her.
Brand new Jan Dan podcast. Number one podcast in the world. Got a lot to talk about this week. Game of Thrones, injuries, and
Tim wondered if we're going to talk about Game of Thrones injuries. Who's day-to-day for next week's episode? This is the worst play of the day. Malik Beasley taking a tumble.
Back in the olden days, if you were day-to-day, you're dead.
A switch hitter trying to handle
like, if you have a cold, you're dead.
Yeah, pretty much. I'm diagnosing you with death, said all doctors in the old days. What good are you, doctor? I don't know. Just gave me this degree in a stethoscope.
Well, back then they just had magic elixirs, and the elixirs were just booze.
Dan, we blew it in various things. I called Andrew Cogliano Alex Cogliano. Brutal. I also said Ari Adrianza's home run in the Astros-Twins game. So the top of the third, he was in the bottom of the third. And you said that, you said you told producer Tim you want to see shots of the cannon when the Jackets score on Wednesday. They play Tuesday. So.
Oh, I was a day ahead.
You were, you're always a day ahead.
That's right.
You're always a step ahead of everybody.
Exactly.